Hello and a very warm welcome to Insight. I'm Amandra Bhatt. Yoga has truly become global. From Paris to China, from Siachen to Times Square in New York, thousands of enthusiasts across the globe performed asanas, marking the first International Day of Yoga on Sunday, an idea first mooted by Prime Minister Narendra Modi at the United Nations General Assembly last September. The event is being seen as a huge success with the overwhelming international response it received, and India setting two Guinness World Records of holding the largest yoga class in one day and for the participation of the largest number of nationalities in a single yoga event. But is this also a huge success for India's soft power? We discuss in today's Insight. And to discuss the same, we are joined in our studios by a distinguished panel. Please welcome Suresh K. Goyal. He's a former Indian ambassador. Welcome to the program, Ambassador Goyal. We are also joined by Vijay Kranti. He's a senior journalist. Welcome to the program, Mr. Kranti.
Thank you.
And later in the program, we'll be joined by Sheshadri Chari, a member of the BJP's national executive. He's also a foreign policy analyst. Mr. Vijay Kranti, yeah. I'd like to begin with you. You know, truly a landmark event celebrated across the world with almost like a never seen before spectacle.
Yes.
How do you view its success?
One is, yoga is not a new thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that the world never knew about yoga.
Right.
What is new is that the present government has come up with, or I would say, there is a shift in looking at India by the government of India itself.
Mm-hmm.
Or our leadership. And I think Prime Minister Narendra Modi, the way he has started using India's different, I wouldn't say powers, different strengths of India, different, our experience or our, what we call our assets, cultural assets or intellectual assets, traditional, the way he has started using them as a source of power for India. You know, that is making difference. So yoga now, as you saw yesterday, you saw the whole world is, you named all the cities. The whole world is taking interest in it. And suddenly yoga, something which was only India, now it has suddenly become a something universal asset. And the Prime Minister again has said that there is no need of commercialization. Commercialization, or some people thinking that it belongs to us. So this indicates that India has many strengths, inherent strengths, from our as a part of our culture. We have to identify them and use them in, number one, projecting India as, if I use the term, Vishwaguru.
Okay.
You know, we have the knowledge we have, India has. I think nowhere in the world any surviving culture has that much, that great asset of knowledge, information and wisdom, which India has. So I think yoga is beginning of that process.
Okay, but as you said, you know, yoga, this discipline, it's an ancient discipline, something we've known, we've been around for, say, thousands of years.
Yes.
Something which the world has also, the global community as such has also adopted for many decades now. What's different this time around?
See, you will see so many schools in Europe, so many institutions in America, even there are copyright organizations, who have branded some aspects of yoga.
Right.
So yoga has been known already, but this is first time that, rather than some individuals, some groups or some institutions, it is becoming a universal, if I can use the term, fashion. So that is something which makes it look
okay. So yoga belongs to everyone, you're saying.
Yeah. So it's the universalization of yoga.
All right.
Has, you know, taken off yesterday. And I'm sure in coming years, it's going to go further ahead. And it's not going to be one-time event. So, and India is going to be remembered every moment, you know, whenever there is yoga anywhere. So, and that I think is what matters.
Okay.
India comes into the thinking process of ordinary world citizens in a very positive way.
All right.
I think that is the great achievement. That's a major thing.
Okay. Ambassador, well, truly, you know, an incredible event, you know, never seen before moment. Of course, it had its own share of controversies in the events leading up to the International Day for Yoga. But, you know, the fact that this idea was first mooted by the Prime Minister at the UN General Assembly, something that the United Nations quickly adopted, marking 21st of June as the International Day for Yoga. Many are seeing it as a recognition of India's soft power.
Well, I hope you'll give me slightly more than 3 or 4 minutes, so to speak. It's a rather complex subject, and I should use my experience also as the head of ICCR, the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, before I retired in 2013. When you want to conduct international diplomacy, or when you want to actually conduct your international relations, there are two things which are very important. First, what your objectives are, which is basically the national interest. And more importantly, how you are seen as a country by the other countries.
Okay.
That kind of an image building of a nation is a very important factor in either promoting a dialogue or impeding a dialogue or creating difficulties or being accepted in the conversation, in the negotiations, without bringing in doubts or suspicions. I think one unique feature of yoga now being branded or being projected as a gift of India to the world through this International Yoga Day, most importantly, I would say, is building an image of India which has believed in the unity of mind and body, which has believed in the unity of all human beings, which has believed in what we call the universality of the globe. When we say call about Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, that basically is saying that essentially there is a unity of mind, there is a unity of purpose for the entire human race. And yoga, BBC commentary this time I found the news was very, very good, because for the first time on the BBC I heard a proper explanation of what yoga means, away from just being a physical exercise. You ask about the yoga schools in the different countries. Unfortunately, in those schools, except a few, yoga had been reduced to a kind of a physical exercise regime.
Right.
Dora yoga, nude yoga, this kind of yoga. It remained basically a physical kind of an activity without emphasizing that it actually means bringing together the spirituality and the physicality.
Right.
Without either of which, the human being is incomplete. So I think most important factor really is that India has sent a message to the world that what India represents is yoga. There is a unity of purpose, unity of human beings, which is slightly different from how India had been understood till now. Either Bollywood or IT or this or that, but really without understanding the spiritual or the value system that India represents. That is number one. I think that's the most important thing. And this is the singular achievement which is completely different from religious interpretations and so on and so forth. Religion has nothing to do about it.
Right.
It is spirituality. It is a value system. And number two, I would say that yoga itself does not talk about power. Power basically is, and Mr. Kranti and I were discussing it outside, what is power? Power is a projection of force. We do not want projection of force when we want to engage in dialogue. We want understandings to be promoted.
Right.
And yoga, and that is actually the true art of cultural diplomacy, where without showing that you are giving something or you are doing something or you have your strength in some areas, you basically say that, all right, this is what we believe in, this is what you believe in, let us come and talk to each other on the basis of our value systems. We will come to an understanding, and there should be no problems. That is what cultural diplomacy is all about, which is very different from the projection of soft power.
All right.
But soft power is about managing conflicts.
Okay.
Cultural diplomacy is about promoting understandings.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a distinction. And yoga is a great value system on the basis of which this understanding can be promoted and therefore can be a very powerful system available to us to engage in developing that universal understanding.
And we have succeeded in doing that.
I think we are perhaps, when he said we are the Vishwa Guru, I don't want to sound, you know, kind of egoist or the, or supremacist really, but the fact is that we have these ancient beliefs which can be useful to the world, and we should bring them to the knowledge of the world.
And how does it come in, you know, in diplomacy? How can it be of use to a country in conducting diplomacy?
Very useful. When I mentioned in the beginning that when you want to talk to others in terms of promoting your objectives, there are two ways. Either what you state can create a suspicion about you or doubt about what you mean, or it can be taken on the face value and create an understanding. If the other people know which kind of value system you come from, their interpretation about you will be different.
Right.
Same thing that I say or somebody else says will be different. Understood differently depending upon where we come from. So if we say that we come from a system where we believe in universal understanding, that we don't believe in frictions, we don't believe in differences,
right,
I think what we say will be better understood.
Yes.
And therefore if we promote our place in the negotiations and make us much better understood.
Okay.
And help us in accomplishing our objectives.
Okay, Mr. Vijayakant Kranti, would you like to come in on that, on you know, on the issue of cultural diplomacy and how yoga can be a good tool?
I'll only give you one example, because I am a very keen observer of China. For last 4 decades, I've been observing China very keenly. And unfortunately, there have been very, very rare occasions when China would love to either join hands with India at the international level or support India's views or proposals. But did you notice that this was first time perhaps when the issue of yoga being accepted internationally, becoming a part of the calendar of United Nations, we found that China's attitude was positive. You know, this is what Ambassador Goel just now said. This is exactly what a nation like India should do. You come out with something, a great asset which you have, and which stays with you, which has refined over centuries, thousands of years, millennia, with you, and which you can now share with the rest of world, and it is very useful for the rest of world. So then you become in the image of India in terms of diplomacy. If you know, people of my age remember when I was a school kid, how India was treated at international level. Any minister going abroad, they will take it for granted that he has come for, you know, taking some support, some money, some, you know, arms or some, you know, so almost like a beggar's treatment. But now you see India is being received, being perceived as a nation which can give a lot to the rest of world. So yoga is something, if we start with it, and there are many other things, you know, our Ayurveda is there, there are a lot of literature is there, you know, the Vedas, which many times people misinterpret because of lack of wisdom, lack of knowledge, they interpret those things as something related to religion. But he used the right term, Ambassador Goel used the term, it's spiritual. And those people who cannot distinguish difference between spiritualism and religion, they will be always confused. Even they will, you know, associate yoga with religion. Some people are trying to do that. It only shows their lack of understanding. So I would come back to that point, that yoga is a beginning of what you call cultural diplomacy, where India stands at a better place compared to most other nations. And which is something a unique, very welcome change. You know, that India is accepted as a nation which is a little above others. It has something to offer. So I personally believe that this trend has to be encouraged.
Okay.
And it should not only look like initiative of Prime Minister Narendra Modi or BJP party or NDA. It should be taken as an Indian initiative.
An Indian initiative. But Ambassador Goyal, you know, this is something yoga I'm talking about. It's something which, you know, has been a common theme in the Prime Minister's visits to China, South Korea, Mongolia. You think it has helped India in its engagement with China?
Yes. I think for the first time when you had this demonstration of Tai Chi and yoga together.
Right.
I mean, that was a great example of how the old value systems can promote an understanding and dialogue between two civilizations. Even if there are differences. And I think that is one more thing which I want to point out really. I find that unlike many other value systems where obedience and following a certain regime is the most important part, and that is part of Confucianism also, where it teaches you hierarchy and everything, the uniqueness of our own value system is that we are always encouraged to be respectful, but to be able to question other values, what the others are saying. And therefore, be an individual. When we say, "Aham Brahmasmi," basically what it means is that I am Brahma. That means I have that much strength in me that I can look at what is around me and yet be part of it.
Okay.
So in that sense, I think to be able to question and yet really come to an understanding is a great value system that we have inherited. So I think doing these things like we talked about Tai Chi and yoga doing with other countries, taking into Mongolia is always very useful. One more thing, and I think that is what Mr. Kranti said, and I am saying again, yoga should not be misunderstood as a kind of aggregate of various asanas.
Okay.
Asanas are a very useful way to achieve that kind of unison of body and mind. But that unison of body and mind can be achieved in different ways, even if you do not have place for doing those asanas.
Right.
For example, our various system of performing arts, Bharatanatyam, you take Odissi or whatever it is, those are not purely just physical activities. They require a kind of a mental dedication to the theme that you're performing and bring in the spirituality of the human being into those subjects. So you actually are doing yoga when you're performing Odissi. I mean, if you're doing it properly, yes. If you're doing it only as a kind of physical movement, then no. But if you're a good dancer like Sonal Mansingh, there are others. If you are doing Odissi or if you are doing Bharatanatyam like Saroja Vaidyanathan, they understand what it means really.
Right.
So there are ways to do yoga without doing asanas. And it's, the reason I say that is it's not always possible to limit yoga to the asanas. As a value system, it goes beyond those.
Right. So there is a meditative aspect to it,
absolutely.
You're saying.
Absolutely.
You know, I'll come back to the issue of, you know, how yoga can be used as a tool in cultural diplomacy, the term you'd like to use, and not soft power. You know, many critics would also say that, you know, how these events are always high on symbolism, high on optics, and go, and you know, they barely go beyond, you know, just the optics of all of that. What would you say to it?
Metaphors are important. Shakuntalam or Meghdoot, I mean, if you read those, these are all about metaphors. So to convey a message, metaphors, symbolism are important. The problem would be that if it remains limited to those symbolisms.
Right.
You have to go beyond the symbolism into its inherent meaning. But after all, I'm not a practicing Hindu. But a practicing Hindu, those who go to the temples, when they're praying before the Shiva Murti, It's not Shiva per se, it's a Murti of Shiva. Mm-hmm. But they say Shiva in the Murti. Mm. So if they are doing prayers to Shiva, just looking at the statue but not realizing what Shiva means, then it is useless. Mm. So the symbolism is important because it focuses your mind, it conveys the images to you, but knowing what it implies is also important.
Mm-hmm. And may I add one more point? You spoke of, you used the term, the optics part of it. I'm a photographer also, so I understand, optics as a part of philosophy also.
Okay.
You know, optics of the whole event, and when I say optics, it means there are newspapers full of images.
Right, it was full of such moments.
And those images, if you see, thousands of people sitting in perfect formation.
Hmm.
You know, you see diagonally, these lines are straight. And when you look at straight lines of human beings going up to infinity, up to India Gate, it's a straight line. That part it communicates in so many ways. It number one shows so many people involved. It encourages people to take it seriously. So many people in visual discipline, in otherwise behavioral discipline. That makes people again serious to look at it, to take it seriously. It's not a joke, it's not some, many events you find people look at it as a fun and then they forget it in next 1 minute.
Right.
Yeah. These things, the pictures today you see in newspapers are coming from so many cities.
Right.
Paris, New York, and even Beijing, and there is no end.
Right. In fact, it was telecast live across the world.
So many times the optics are part of a celebration, optics part of an occasion, it has a very serious meaning.
Okay.
It helps in communicating the seriousness of that event.
Okay.
So I think as far as those aspects are concerned, yesterday's event has achieved.
Okay.
It has communicated to the world that it is something serious, it is something acceptable, it is something useful for you, and it's good for every
nation. It's been a success.
So, but again, I will agree with
that. Very briefly.
Yeah. But this, we don't have to stop here. And luckily, United Nations has accepted it as a part of calendar.
Right.
So it's not going to stop.
Okay. Well, with that, we slip into a short break in the program. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
जिन्होंने अपनी हिम्मत अपने हौसले के बल पर लिखी कामयाबी की नई दास्तां और बन गए आम इंसान से खास, ये उन्हीं की कहानी, उन्हीं की जुबानी। देखिए आम आदमी खास पहल हर बुधवार रात 8:30 बजे सिर्फ लोकसभा टेलीविजन पर।
आओ मिलकर छू लें आसमान, हर ओर फैला योग का ज्ञान। अब तो चल पड़ा है कारवां पंख फैलाए, आइए हम सब शामिल इसमें हो जाएं। योग युगांतर जल्द आ रहा है लोकसभा टेलीविजन पर।
भैया कितना हुआ?
49।
फिर भैया जो जाओगे
छुट्टा रख लीजिए।
अरे सुनिए सुनिए मैडम, एक मिनट, 1 रुपया वापस कीजिए ना। 1 रुपया रखिए, बहुत काम आएगा आपके। चलो ये 1 रुपया बड़े काम की चीज है। प्रधानमंत्री सुरक्षा बीमा योजना है, इसमें हर महीने अगर आप केवल 1 रुपए के हिसाब से यानी सालाना 12 रुपए भरते रहे तो भगवान न करे कभी आपके साथ दुर्घटना हो जाए, आप विकलांग हो जाए, कोई अनहोनी हो जाए, तो आपको और आपके परिवार को इस बीमा योजना के तहत 2 लाख रुपए धनराशि मिल सकती है। तो जाइए और बांध लीजिए अपने प्रियजनों के भविष्य पर ये 1 रुपए का सुरक्षा कवच।
All that you wanted to know. All that you wanted to see. Everything related to your health is what we tell you in Healthy India.
जनता के सपने सरकार के काम, करती है संसद सबका समाधान।
सबका साथ सबका विकास, मैं मुझे आपका भी साथ चाहिए।
देखिए हमारी संसद और समझिए कैसे बनता है देश का विधान।
Grab all that is making news headlines in the national, international, business and sports arena. Watch in-depth news analysis, watch perspective.
Are men from Mars?
And women from Venus?
Who is the better half?
Who takes the decisions?
Who is responsible?
Who is demanding?
Who is submissive?
Who is independent?
Can men and women ever find common ground? To find out, watch Gender Discourse. Every Thursday, 4 p.m. only on Lok Sabha Television.
Janata ke sapne, sarkar ke kaam. Karti hai sansad, sabka samadhan.
Sabka saath, sabka vikas. Main, mujhe aapka bhi saath chahiye.
Dekhiye, hamari sansad, aur samjhiye, kaise banta hai desh ka vidhan.
All that you wanted to know. All that you wanted to see. Everything related to your health is what we tell you in Healthy India.
जिन्होंने अपनी हिम्मत अपने हौसले के बल पर लिखी कामयाबी की नई दास्तां और बन गए आम इंसान से खास, ये उन्हीं की कहानी, उन्हीं की जुबानी। देखिए आम आदमी खास पहल हर बुधवार रात 8:30 बजे सिर्फ लोकसभा टेलीविजन पर।
किताबें बहुत कुछ बोलती हैं, लेखनी चलती है और रच जाता है एक नया संसार। किताबों की खामोशी को आओ पहचाने, उसकी दुनिया को समझें और जानें। साहित्य संसार में हर रविवार शाम 7:30 बजे
Welcome back to Insight. We are talking about the success of the International Day of Yoga across the world. And joining us in the program is Shishadri Chari, a well-known foreign policy analyst. He is also a member of the BJP's National Executive. Welcome to the program. Mr. Chari, we've been discussing how, you know, the International Day of Yoga was an idea first mooted by the Prime Minister at the UN General Assembly and how it was adopted by the UN. You know, it's been a great global success. India has in fact registered 2 world records in the Guinness Book of World Records. But you know, how is this exercise going to enhance India's global image is something we've been discussing. What would you say to it?
Certainly, this places India in a very different league. Mm-hmm. India has always been known right from the time of, say, in Gandhi was the first person who I proposed this idea that India is a soft power and India should regain its position as a soft power. Mm-hmm. And this soft power, I mean, now of course the entire discussion on soft power versus hard power is a fallout of, let us say, a little bit of the Cold War strategies. Hmm. Pre-Cold War, there was nothing like soft power and hard power. Hmm. But even now, if we say hard power is military power as against non-military power, then even that doesn't fall into its place. So this whole idea of International Yoga Day, which is a very unique idea in the sense, it's not that people did not know about yoga. Hmm. It's not that people were not celebrating it.
Right.
But the placing it as an international event and getting acceptability all over the world and getting the United Nations to recognize it, all this gives a special space which we did not have earlier. So this does enhance our position in the world community. So that is one. But there is also a cultural component to this. And the cultural component becomes very important if you look at it this way. Like after the during the Second World War, when England was facing financial crunch, somebody suggested to Winston Churchill at that time that why don't we divert some of the funds from AMR for culture to war. He said, then what for are we fighting? Meaning, if you lose your essence, your basic cultural ethos, if you are not able to market it that way, if you are not able to connect yourself with your basic identity vis-a-vis the world, then we have lost our very narrative, the national narrative. So we have been of soft power, and this is exactly how we should be able to market it.
Okay.
Place ourselves in that position, which is practically vacant in the world today. So we have taken a position that is ours, where we did not go and place it, and now we are occupying that position.
Okay.
So I think it fits into the like a jigsaw puzzle. Getting resolved, it has now got resolved.
But you know, since you said India has long been a soft power, and we were known for being a soft power, and now we are in a sense reclaiming that position. But you know, we also have global aspirations. You know, we are all set to overtake China as the world's largest growing economy. We also have a formidable military in place. We are also, you know, one of the world's largest democracies, and so on. How do we balance it out? All, you know, being you know, an economic power as opposed to being just a soft power.
No, this whole idea of balancing it also is something very different. Why should we always balance?
Okay.
We are not balancing. We are not competing with China, or we are not competing with anybody. We are not saying we are emerging as a superpower. We are emerging as a leading nation. So, when you emerge as a leading nation, and when you emerge as a leading economic nation, when you regain your economic power, it need not be at the cost of your original narrative, your original characteristic. So that is what, that is unfortunately the situation vis-a-vis China. China has emerged as a global economic leader, economic power, vis-a-vis the US. But in the process, they have lost a huge amount of their cultural component. So it is, in fact, without losing, unless you lose your cultural component, you could not have become an economic power, is what China's narrative has proposed. As against that, what we are thinking, or our thinking has always been, that we are not here to lose our original characteristic as a nation, as a civilization. We emerge as a civilization, we regain and emerge as an economic power. So emerging as an economic leader or making economic progress, if it is at the cost of our original characteristics and tradition and culture and civilizational ethos, then what have we achieved? That is the whole idea. So it's not the question of balancing.
You wanted to come in here?
I agree with him, and you know, India, in that, India has a very, very special place in the world community. It's not very old in the past. When we were the greatest center of learning, students, scholars from across the world were coming to India, stayed here, and many of them stayed lifelong to learn, to get Indian wisdom, and then went back, you know, with that. Yoga is only a part of that. So I can see that if this process is going ahead, very soon in future, you are going to see India, I use the term Vishwa Guru, in one more field, and that is called religious coexistence. It is in India today, you know, whatever our newspapers, politicians, you know, that cynicism, you just leave it for a while and just see how many people of different religions, there is no, almost no religion in the world which does not exist in India. And whether it is Christians, Muslims, or you know, their total number of their population is far more than so many countries put together of the same religion across the world. And we are all surviving, we are living together. We have learned living with each other, we have learned respecting each other, we have learned, you know, receiving from each other, wisdom and so many things. I can visualize that if we keep on the right track, if we use, like yoga we have started, very soon you will see in the West, in the Middle East, where religious crisis, religious clash has become a game of every day. I'm sure they are going to come to India and ask India, please let us understand how you live, how all so many religions can survive, how you can, you know, not only tolerate each other, you respect each other, you learn from each other. And this is another field where India can be Vishwaguru for the rest of world. And the clash of civilization, the kind of term which is used, India is just the other end of the rainbow of that. It is living together of or cooperation of civilizations. So I think the yoga is a beginning in that direction. And we must continue for next, not only, you know, this, I'm not talking in terms of the lifespan of this government. I'm talking of coming next 10, 20, 50 governments. You know, this we have to continue. This is our national strength. It has nothing to do with politics.
Mr. Chari, you know, something that we discussed earlier in the program before you joined us, you know, the fact that yoga has been a recurring theme in the Prime Minister's recent visits to China, his visit to Mongolia, South Korea, and how, you know, he has tapped into India's soft power potential otherwise as well, you know, be it Buddhism and so on. You know, how do you think it's going to help us as a tool in diplomacy, it be, you know, being a soft power?
Certainly. It's not that and we are not looking at all these aspects only as a tool. They should have been part of our diplomatic engagement even otherwise. See, it was only sometime during 1992-93 during the Narasimha Rao regime when he was a prime minister that we started engaging with the South. And South-South cooperation and Southeast Asia, look-east policy were all revealed. Now, look-east is not just an economic policy. Our engagement with East and Southeast Asia has been very long. It has gone on for almost 1,000 years. And some of the, like we have a Southeast Asia policy, which has been part of our engagement for thousands of years. China had a South policy and we were the South of China. So the Chinese visitors came to India and they benefited. And if you look at even the 250-300-year-old history, look at the US, which developed, which emerged as a land of opportunities. The British, they say, the Britannica rules the world. So the British ruled the whole world not on the basis of their military power, but on the basis of the trade, on the basis of the language, on the basis of their ethics, on the basis of the judiciary, on the basis of the cultural component of England. So these are all absolutely part and parcel of the diplomatic engagement with any country of the world. So once you have your own moorings clear, and when you are strong on your moorings, and with that, if you reach out to the world, you naturally go and get newer friendships. You are able to open new vistas. So it's not that these are being used as a tool for diplomacy. This has been part of the diplomatic engagement over a long period of time. Even before we had what we call the formal democratic arrangement as we have today. So I think this will, in the longer period, this will really help us.
Ambassador Goyal, you wanted to come in here?
Just two or three things. I think my pet peeve really. First of all, because I think we are talking about the soft power once again. So I just wanted to get back to the idea. that when we talk about the conflict of civilizations, when we talk about the power projections, incidentally, you mentioned that this was actually pre-Cold War concept as a power projection or the distinction between the soft power and the hard power. My own analysis as part of the Foreign Office suggested that the use of soft power was really advocated by Joseph Nye as a consequence to the failure of use of hard power in Iraq as after 2000, I forget the year when Iraq invasion took place. The problem with using soft power as a response to the hard power really is that it still remains basically a projection of strength. Whether we have softer assets or whatever it is, it remains a projection of strength. I think what yoga does is that really it gets into a much more philosophical and deeper issue of engaging both at the spiritual and the mental level with the people and the societies and treating them not as a kind of a target but as a part in the process which can contribute to the universal thing. However, that was more philosophical really. But coming back to the issue of, and I think I had said earlier that I have been the head of the Indian Council for Cultural Relations till 2013 before I retired. And you are absolutely right that this is that cultural diplomacy has been the part of our civilizational ethos. Not just after 47 or in a kind of an organized functioning of the government.
Right.
But it has been a part of our civilizational ethos for more than 5 millennia. Because when we talk about really working on the basis of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, when we talk on the basis of Sahana Bhunaktu, we are basically equating us, or we are putting us at the same pedestal as the other, and we are encouraging the process of the dialogue rather than talking in terms of power equations or the power confrontations. Silk Road, very often we think of Silk Road as the route through which you had to trade and commerce, and now in the new idiom, when China proposes OBOR, we look at Silk Route as or the Maritime Silk Route as a projection of Chinese strength or the Chinese strategic gains. But we must not forget that India was an equal part at a spiritual level, at a philosophical level of Silk Route. During the Chola Empire, the Maritime Silk Route was as much a part of Indian trade routes.
Right.
Bali Jatra is today a big event. And in Orissa, and from Paradip Port, what is today Paradip, that was a launching pad for Bali Yatra. And that was a year-long event. And the trade and commerce, that was the roof for trade and commerce, but we just not, as you very rightly said, it was not just trade and commerce, but it was also culture.
Right.
It was ideas. So when Xuanzang came to India and then back to Dunhuang and to Xi'an through the Silk Route, it was a reaffirmation of the fact that the human societies have to talk to each other, they have to interact with each other.
Right.
That is a power point number two. And number three, I don't think that there can be any solution to the competition between people. Competition will take place.
Right.
The only caution we need to exercise that competition should not give rise to confrontation or wars.
Right. Of course, that's a separate debate in itself. We'll take a break on that note. We'll come back with the final segment of the show. Stay with us.
जनता के सपने सरकार के काम, करती है संसद सबका समाधान।
सबका साथ सबका विकास, में मुझे आपका भी साथ चाहिए।
देखिए हमारी संसद और समझिए कैसे बनता है देश का विधान।
All that you wanted to know. All that you wanted to see. Everything related to your health is what we tell you in Healthy India.
Are men from Mars?
And women from Venus?
Who is the better half?
Who takes the decisions?
Who is responsible?
Who is demanding?
Who is submissive?
Who is independent?
Can men and women ever find common ground? To find out, watch Gender Discourse. Every Thursday, 4 p.m. only on Lok Sabha Television.
Kisi ki nazar na lage.
Ko kisi ki nazar nahi lage.
बुरी नजर से बचाने के लिए इतना कुछ, सबसे पहले सिर्फ बीमारियों की नजर से तो बचाइए।
वो कैसे?
संपूर्ण टीकाकरण से, ये बच्चे को कई जानलेवा बीमारियों से जिंदगी भर बचाएगा। 2 साल तक के बच्चों का संपूर्ण टीकाकरण जरूर कराएं।
मिशन इंद्रधनुष,
जिंदगी इंद्रधनुष बनाएं।
Welcome back to Insight. We are talking about the success of the International Day of Yoga that was marked on Sunday. Mr. Chari, I'll continue the discussion with you. You know, the Prime Minister has also said how, you know, yoga is an ancient Indian legacy which is some preserves, you know, international celebration, and does this event commemorating this ancient Indian discipline. But, you know, you think there's more that India needs to do to establish its position as, you know, as a culturally influential nation in the world?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. If we need to do much more than what we have, this is, I think this is only a beginning. And we have really sensed success. Probably for all those naysayers who were very skeptical about yoga being projected as a universal concept and then India taking its position and all that, whoever had very pessimistic about it have all ended now.
Okay.
This success has really, it's an eye-opener for us, and it should be an eye-opener for the government, and it should also be an eye-opener for all those who are engaged in this. I can say that I have been engaged in this kind of cultural propagation for some time. As a trustee of Delhi International Art Festival, I can say the kind of treatment that we give to our artists, the kind of projection that we are doing to all kinds of performing arts is abysmally bad.
Okay.
With all my due respects to my friend who was formerly concerned with ICCR, I think our culture ministry, our ministry of tourism, ICCR and all these cultural bodies will have to really do much more than what they are doing now. I think they should take a leaf out of the yoga lessons and the way we have been able to project ourselves as a soft power.
Okay.
It's not just projecting as a soft power, it is actually projecting the real India outside the world.
Okay.
The real India which will be respected. And to think that by projecting our culture, by projecting our civilizational ethos, we will be losing out on our economics is absolutely wrong basis of thinking.
Okay.
It is the other way around. It is always because of our education, our faith, our philosophy, our traditions, our culture, our civilizational aspects. It is these things which has been the vehicle of our trade and commerce.
Okay.
So I think we should have more emphasis on this, and we should have more India festivals, like the Edinburgh festival, like all these festivals that are being taking place all over the world.
Right.
We should be part and parcel of that cultural component of the world. And that is what the world is expecting from us.
Okay.
And this will automatically result in our economic and trade commerce engagement with the rest of the world.
Okay. Ambassador, I wanted to come in, I'll come to you.
No, I felt compelled to come in because Mr. Chari referred to me as a former ICCR, and I fully agree that I think in terms of using our value system, our civilization as a kind of medium to engage with the world, we have done very little really, and there is possibly a lot more that we can do. I think we need to change our mindset.
Okay.
Incidentally, I wanted to mention that I have been a great supporter of DIAF. And I think during my time, DIF got the largest amount of support from ICCR.
Thank you. This is the ninth year of Delhi International Art Festival, where more than 500 international dance and performing art teams participate.
They all used to come through ICCR at
exactly.
that time.
Mm-hmm. ICCR has been really doing a lot of good work. I hope they continue to do that good work now.
But I was saying something different. I'm not going to talk about ICCR anymore because I think if I can say something about ICCR at this stage, ICCR has to understand what it actually is meant to be and fulfill that mandate. Unfortunately, the resources available to ICCR sometimes constrain fulfilling the mandate, but let me not make this discussion as a kind of ICCR. But what I'm saying here is that culture or the civilization is not limited to one aspect or the other aspect.
Mm-hmm.
It is actually really projecting India as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
And the yoga is, I think, is one very, very elementary, one very basic belief system.
Okay.
We believe that yes, we are all total human beings, where the spirituality, the body and the mind must come together. There are several things that we need to do. And I think if we can, I have always said it, that by promoting everything, doing everything else, I think we need to engage in discussions, conferences, seminars, use our academic and scholarly background and traditions to convey to the world that this is what we believe in. Let me give one example. 3 years ago, we had done, at that time ICCR, we have a system of doing conferences, international conferences. And I was really exploring as to what we can do with France. Because Europe is very different, really. And then I thought to myself that if there is something common between India and France, it is the belief in the socialist liberation. And for me, the liberation or the democratic values was a key word. So what we did was we explored the value of liberalism in cultural ideas. And we came together, it was a huge success. So I think we need to really explore those ideas together with the world, just like yoga, Tai Chi, etc., etc.
Incidentally, as picking up from what he said, China has been consistently looking into the aspect of spreading its wings on the basis of Buddhism. Although as a state they don't have any religion, they don't believe in it.
They are atheists basically. State. Right.
So, but in spite of that, they have totally changed their approach towards culture and faith. And they are now marketing Buddhism in a very big way, and they have been able to penetrate into a number of markets only through Buddhism, as using Buddhism as a vehicle. And here is a country which is the repository of Buddhism. Buddha was born here. This is the land of Buddha. And we have not been able to really make it a cultural aspect of our
There has to be attitudinal change in our thinking as a political system, as a democracy, as a nation, as a society. In last 60 years, what we have seen is that our leaders, political leaders especially, they have been in a mode of self-denial and self-evasion and being ashamed of our own culture, our own assets. So that has ultimately resulted in our definition of secularism is being anti-religion, and unfortunately, which is the which can be the worst definition of secularism, rather than so this beginning on yoga, I think, I hope it takes us to a state where we start feeling proud of our own as cultural assets, our philosophical assets, our spiritual assets, and then use these all these aspects as a part of our what we can offer to the rest of world.
So you talk about
that requires a thinking, a basic change in thinking, at our political level, at the level of our intellectuals. You know, the way we have, our intellectuals have denied Indian literature, Indian wisdom. You have historians who can't read one sentence in Sanskrit.
That's not going to
We have to change that attitude and we have to come back to understand our strengths and build on those strengths, you know, as Vishwaguru.
A quick one, as a brand India you're talking about, which we need to position to the world. Yes, Ambassador Goyal, very quickly.
Very quickly, you talked about Buddhism and I fully agree with you. And I'm very happy that you didn't really refer to Confucianism, which the whole world talks about.
Yes.
And from that point of view, all I want to say is that please make Nalanda University as a center for learning for Buddhism. And unless we actually establish that kind of learning centers on Buddhism, we will not be able to reclaim our Buddhist leadership.
Okay, and last word from you, Mr. Chari, on, you know, this larger brand India and how we can connect it with our ancient civilizational past. What else needs to be done? Yoga, okay, we've done it. Buddhism is one you mentioned. What are the other areas? Very quickly.
Yeah, the what I said was language. Sanskrit, for example, is the mother of all languages, they say. So, if you look at the language aspect of the world, there are very few languages, like, for example, Farsi. Farsi is the only language, only ancient language in the world, which is still being followed in a country and which is still the official language of a country, of the same country of which it was born. Unfortunately, that is the position that Sanskrit can have.
Okay.
So instead of looking at it from either philosophical or political or religious point of view, we should look at it from that point of view.
Okay, all right.
For example, use of Urdu.
Okay.
Urdu is an Indian language. It's not a language of Muslims. It's a language of India. And which is very rich in its culture. It's very rich in its literature. So we should be able to use language, faith, philosophy, and our civilizational value system.
All right. Well, with that, I'm afraid I have to leave it at that. We're completely out of time. On that note, it's time for me to wrap up this discussion on Insight. I'd like to thank all my guests for coming to the studios. It was a pleasure having you all here. That's it for now in this edition of Insight. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.